blood to cover every man's sin, where it could be saved there. Yeah. You got one drop of sin on Calvary's cross for that. Keith, come on, say a few words to us.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Hey. Will we make the devil mad tonight?
Hey,
buddy.
Yeah.
I'm believing I'm God.
Yeah.
He doesn't figure it out. We want to go ahead.
Yeah. We run out.
Get out of the way. Like this church is just open. And I mean, the first Sunday I came here, to three different people preached and was sung for about 4 or 5 minutes. That was the first Sunday. I've been to churches. I remember I was in the one church that wasn't around here, around Nashville, but they had the program out, what songs they was going to sing, what the preacher was going to preach, and everything.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, Brother Robert, I walked up here not knowing what I was
doing. Yeah, there you go.
You know, they want to program that out and everything, that's fine, but don't have a fit when it don't blow up like it. Bible said don't hinder the Spirit. Supposed to hold back. You know, Jesus said that, and he told all them old priests and all that had all the rules and regulations, he said, you put things on men that even you can't carry.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, so the church needs to just let God do the work, and we just do what he said.
Yeah.
Come on. Jesus said we're in the world, but we're not supposed to be of it. You know, the world does its part. The world is acting exactly the way it's supposed to.
Yeah.
We're the ones that fall short.
Yeah.
We're the ones that don't do what we're supposed to.
Yeah. Yeah. Come
on, brother. And y'all may think this is a coincidence or whatever, but I don't believe in coincidences.
Yeah.
God's Bible's turn to Mark chapter 6. Well, good. Well, when God laid this on my heart, I was kind of, well, that might be me. You know, we're having fish fry, that might just mean anything about it. No, it wasn't. That when the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, this is a deserted place, and already the hour is late. Send them away that they may go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread. They have nothing to eat. But he answered and said to them, you give them something to eat. And they said to him, shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat? But he said to them, how many loaves do you have? Go and see. And when they found out, they said, fish, 5 and 2 fish. Then he commanded them to make them all sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in ranks, 150. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, blessed, and broke the loaves, and gave them to his disciples to sit before them, and the 2 fish he divided among them all. So they all ate and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fish. Now those who had eaten the loaves were about 5,000 men. Now, you know, this ain't just a miracle that Jesus did. I mean, this is more than just the record for the biggest fish fry. There's so many lessons in this. You know, first of all, Jesus saw a need. It says in that he had compassion for these people.
Yeah.
And that's something we need today.
Yeah.
You know, we can sit around and talk about how bad things are and how this and what we change and what we do. But when it comes time for action, we fall short.
Yeah.
You know, when you get down to it, that's what love is. We think it's all googly and all that, and you get all in the heart. Love is an action. Because when you love somebody, it causes you to do something.
Yeah.
Jesus loved us, and it caused him to die on the cross.
Yeah.
Love is an action. It's not judgmental. It doesn't look at you. It is not based on the other person. It's based on who's doing the loving. And that's why the love of God is so important because it doesn't look at anything. It doesn't matter if you deserve it or not. God loves you anyway. Now people can receive it. They can reject it or they can receive it. It doesn't mean it doesn't exist. They can die and go to hell. It'd be their choice.
Yeah, right.
I'm like Brother Tony said a while ago, you know, I didn't left all that behind. I'm not going back.
Yeah.
Paul said, if you build the things that you want to destroy, you make yourselves a transgressor.
That's what he said.
I used to be a bad alcoholic. And I've been around it. I went and played golf and people were drank and I smelled it. And I'm like, oh man, that's what I used to smell like. It was nasty. And I'm like, this don't bother you or not. Don't bother me a bit. You go right ahead. You drink all you want to. I said, it don't make you want one. I said, no, it's far from it. Because God took it from him. It's God that took it from him. I don't know if it's the 10-step program or the 15-step program or whatever the step program means. One step, no God. Master Cato said, if there was 100 steps between me and Jesus, Jesus would take 99 of them.
Yeah.
That's kind of God I say.
Yeah.
He don't ask us for a whole lot. Just like right here, the disciples, they didn't believe. They'd seen all these miracles already. That's why Jesus said, now you're going to find out how much you got to tell them. Because he wanted them to admit it. That way, when he done a miracle, they know they didn't hardly have nothing to do with it.
Right.
It wasn't a matter if they had one. It wasn't a matter if they didn't have any. He created everything and could have boosted them there they went.
Yeah.
But the thing about it is he wanted the disciples to see.
Yeah.
That you don't hardly have nothing without me.
Yeah.
What you do have, I provided that also. So when we admit, without God, we're nothing. Jesus says you are nothing.
That's right.
You're nothing without
God. Our good, our best is as filthy rags.
That's right. Amen.
You know, that might be bad to say, but we just might as well go ahead and admit it. We got a God that is alive, still alive today. He done everything he had to do so that we could go to heaven.
Yeah.
He gives us everything we need.
Yeah.
And everything we want. Everything we need.
It's
a big difference. And sometimes when you don't get what you want, you better be thankful for that also.
Come on, brother.
Because God knows what we can handle and what we can't.
That's right.
I ain't got a whole lot of money. I keep thinking, because God knows I might not even handle it. The reason I ain't got it. But as you see here, he wanted the disciples to admit that they didn't have much without him.
Yeah.
And I don't care who you are here tonight. I don't care what. Use this as an example. You just give God what you want, he'll do the rest.
Yeah.
He will do the rest.
Yeah.
He said, well, what do you got? Five loaves and 2 fish. Just give me what you got. And I'll do it.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's what God asked us to do.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
It don't matter if you've got $5.
Come on.
God can turn that into work a miracle with you.
Yes.
And you might think, well, I'm not a preacher, I'm not a teacher, or nothing else. If you've been saved by the grace of God, you've got a testimony.
Yes.
There's somebody out there that you can touch.
Yes.
There's somebody out there that you can witness to. There's somebody out there that's hungry, just like this multitude here, and Jesus is wanting to use you to feed them.
Yes.
That's all. We're just here. That's the reason why we're still here. There's somebody still on this earth that's supposed to be saved.
That's, right.
That's the only reason we're still here.
Yeah.
He might be here tonight. Somebody might get saved tonight, and boof, we go right out of here. If anybody here is wrong, I'm telling you, you can have this t-shirt when I'm gone.
Yeah.
You can have it. But he used these. He used them. And I tell you, something else is not a coincidence. This is just how God works. Now, I serve a creative God, a different God, And this is not a coincidence. How many disciples was there? 12. How many baskets full was it? 12. Come on. Not a coincidence. Maybe Jesus said, there's another hint. You need to believe me. You see all these miracles, believe me. When you get down and out and your faith is lacking, think back to all the things God's done for you before. Paul said that we have all the old prophets in the Old Testament as examples for us. To know that our God lives. To know that God does work in us, for us, and through all our other brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. And you know, it don't matter what anybody's got, what anybody don't have. You know, we all struggle.
Yeah.
You know, I remember somebody told me a story one time of this businessman. He worked all his life. He gathered up all his riches. He had all his houses, all his different cars. And then he was at his funeral. And somebody said, well, how much did he eat?
Every bit of it.
Yeah. You can't take it with you.
Yeah.
You can't take it with you. You know, when your family's sick and you're in the hospital, or when you're down there and you're in the hospital and you got family there, you don't cry out to your money to help. You cry out to God. You find out what's important. You find out what's important. And when you're down in the valley, you find out what's important. You know, that's when you grow. And these disciples here, they've been going around with Jesus and they've seen all these things and they still lacked in the faith. So, you know, that's another example for us. You know, don't get down on yourself. Don't beat yourself up. You know, I'm not saying to, you know, commit a sin and not think nothing about it, but you can't put yourself down like that. God loves you, and if He loves you that much, He sent His Son to die on the cross, you're worth something. You're not just anybody.
That's right.
You're a child of God, and that is special. God created you. You're wonderfully made. There's nobody else like you. I know all y'all think, thank God there's nobody else like you. I'm telling you, there's nobody else like you. And don't try to be somebody else. I remember when I first started preaching, I'd see somebody, if this had been 2 years ago, I'd been, oh, after you got up here, I'd been, oh, wow, I can't get up there. But now, I don't worry about it. I just get up here and do what God
did.
Nobody else can be you. And you may, you know, I love to play golf. And boy, I played with people before, and boy, they just wear me out. I played with this 70-year-old man one time. Not talking about age. Come on, brother. I played with him and. And he got up to the elderly teachers. And I was back there with the young men's teachers. And he teed off, and I was behind him, and boy, my ball just went right over his, and as I was driving by him, I said, did you see my ball just way at you, little girl? He didn't say nothing. He went up there and hit it, and it just stayed right in the middle of the fairway, and I hit mine, and I went, he wore me out every single time. Because he just stayed.
Yeah.
He just stayed where he needed to stay. In the fairway. He didn't get off in the edges, off in the trees, and in the bushes. I'd get up there and wires and the thickets and trying to walk on the dog. He stay out there in the fairway. That's what we need to do. We should stay out here. Not out in the thicket over where I'd go. They call it a slice. like them briars would slice my leg. We need to stay out in the short grass with God, because it's all better when we're out there alive. We can see things a lot better. We can go a lot better.
Yeah,
yeah, there you go.
Why wouldn't you up there on the green flag? Black balls.
Yeah.
Go along, don't you? You know, learn that thick stuff in the rough and it stopped right where it's at, don't you? Hey, women, you know I can't hear it. I mean, we stand with God.
Yeah.
That's the only way we're going to make it.
Yeah.
We can't make it no other way.
That's right.
I mean, you can't rely on self.
That's right.
I died 8 years ago.
Yeah.
I have a friend of mine that's got a shirt that says a dead man walking. Galatians 2:20. Paul said it's no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. It's no longer my life, but it's God's life.
Yeah.
And we need to do the best that we possibly can.
Amen.
Disciples, it wouldn't matter if there was 100,000 people there. Jesus still would have failed.
Yeah.
It don't matter if there's 1 or 100. We just use what God gave us. Because God's the one gave it to you. The Bible says that He gives different people gifts. Some for teaching, some for pastoring, some for singing. I don't know where I was at for even having
that. Yeah.
But he gives different gifts. But the thing about it is, it's all used for the glory of God.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, God will use you if you will. Let it. I knew before I started preaching, I didn't want to because I knew what was going to happen. I knew I was going to have to give up some stuff. I was going to have to quit being so selfish. But see, once I passed that, God blessed me.
There you go.
It's our nature to be selfish. That's why it says, love others if you love yourself. Mm-hmm. You ain't going to let yourself starve.
Yeah.
You ain't going to, if you were sitting on the side of the road, you wouldn't go past you. You'd stop and help them. That's why I said, love others if you love yourself.
Yeah.
We love ourselves, we're going to take care of ourselves. We need to show other people the same. No judging, no nothing else. Because Jesus said there was all these men out there, they were men without a sheep. They were sheep without a shepherd. You know sheep's the dumbest animal they're in?
Yeah.
Sheep are dumb.
There you go. Yeah.
And you got, He called us sheep. Yeah. He was a shepherd. And the captain came to the God. Why do you think the Bible says we fall short of the glory of God? Because we're in our own self. We fall down. When Jesus was walking on the water, I love that example. It reminds me of me all the time because Peter was extreme.
Yeah.
You know, whatever Peter was doing, he was doing it all the way.
Yeah.
And Jesus got out of the boat. And Peter, you know, he said, can I come out there? And now the person goes in there. Jesus said, come.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, Peter walked out there. He got scared. He got his eyes off Jesus and he fell in the water.
Yeah.
What happened to us? When we're out there in the world, we're going along fine as long as we keep our eyes going forward. Paul said, I'm not looking behind no more.
Yeah, that's right.
He said, I'm going forward to the high calling of God. I'm going after the prize.
Yeah.
He said, when we're all in the race, said, everybody's running. So we need to just do what God lets us do.
Amen.
God asked us to do.
That's right.
I remember I was sitting here for a month. I'm ashamed to say it, but I'm human. I sat in here for 4 weeks straight. God telling me to get up and preach, and I want to do it.
No.
No, I didn't. I told God to tell me.
Yeah.
God uses other people. Sometimes when we're not listening to God, He says somebody else, because sometimes we will listen to other people before we will God.
Yeah.
And I've got people that, you know, I talk to, and you know, that I can talk to. But you know, sometimes we just need to get off the phone and go to the throne. That needs to be the first thing we do. Go to God first. God will use other people.
Yeah.
But we need to go to God first. And a lot of times we'll go to people not knowing what to do when we really already know what we're supposed to do. We just want somebody else to agree with us. That way we'll feel better about it. When we know that what we're supposed to do. And if it wasn't, if it didn't hurt to do it, it wouldn't be called sacrifice. We have to sacrifice ourselves in order for God's kingdom to grow.
All right.
You know, there's many places you can be tonight. But you're here. And God's blessed you for it.
Yeah.
Amen.
Oh, I got it.